I'm Dan Meads. I'm the NDP candidate during the federal by-election that's happening for Calgary Centre. And it's my job to be here today and have a discussion as best I can. We're quite privileged to have the panel of folks that we have today to talk to us about Bill C-30. First, we've got Andrew Cash. Andrew Cash is the MP for Davenport in Toronto. He was elected in 2011 and is the Heritage Critic for the official opposition of the NDP. So I'm calling Andrew up in a moment. We have Brian Seaman from the Alberta Civil Liberties Research Centre. Brian's been a research associate at the Alberta Civil Liberties Research Centre since November of 2004. He has two major works in progress for the Centre. One addresses the limits of multicultural accommodation in a liberal democracy, and one addresses the increasing surveillance of our private lives and dwellings by agencies of the state. Often rationalized as a necessary intrusion in the interests of fighting crime or preventing acts of terrorism. So we'll hear from Ryan in a second. We have Tom Keenan from the University of Calgary. Tom combines a deep computer science background with a lively appreciation of the legal and social issues that make technology so interesting. He was educated at Columbia University, earning degrees in philosophy, mathematics, engineering, and education. An information and travel junkie, he learned how to fly a plane in Alberta. But this is a super biography. I'm afraid the rest of us are going to be intimidated if I finish it. So I'm going to skip to the bottom. He serves on many boards, including the ICTC, Council of Canadians, and the SEEDS Foundation. At the University of Calgary, he's been a professor in several faculties, pioneering dean of the Faculty of Continuing Education, and founding director of the Shad Valley Program for Gifted Teenagers. He currently serves as a professor of environmental design, adjunct professor of computer science, and fellow for the Center of Military and Strategic Studies. Welcome, Tom, second. Lastly, we have Lisa Sayre, Association of Progressive Communication. Lisa studied international development and has a master's degree in international and intercultural communication. She started with the Association for Progressive Communications in 2008 as a CETA intern and is now currently working as Communications, Media, and Promotions Associate. She's fluent in four languages and has lived, worked, and traveled in many different parts of the world. She is the primary editor of APC.org. In English and French, and writes about internet and other technologies for development and internet rights. It's good to have Lisa with us as well. Of the folks that we have here today, I am without a doubt least capable to talk about Bill C-30. But what I will say before I turn the floor over to Andrew is that this is one of the moments where we need to think about what it means to have representation in Parliament. This is one of the moments that proves to us that Calgary needs something more than just another silent backbench MP. Because without the official opposition, without strong voices and dissent, in Ottawa this issue would have been passed, signed, sealed, and delivered before any of us knew what was going on. And so on that note, Andrew Cash.
Thanks, Dan, and welcome everyone. Thank you for being here on what I now understand is one of the most beautiful days we've had in several. Thank you so much for being here. I wanted to do a quick poll quickly. How many people know something about this bill, this lawful access bill? Okay. So then those that don't didn't put their hand up, right? So okay, all right. I think there's a number of things to really get at here, but essentially the federal government of Stephen Harper tabled legislation C-30, which we call in the open media, who are our representatives here, and I'm sure we're going to hear from them in the Q&A, called it unlawful access. The government sort of framed it as lawful access, and those who opposed it sort of called it unlawful access. And part of the reason is because it encroaches on some fundamental aspects of civil liberties that Canadians assume their government is going to protect. primarily in this instance, it's the allowance for law enforcement agencies to compel internet service providers, telecom service providers, to hand over to them your personal information and enough of it that if you knew what you were doing, you could piece together your profile, your habits online, your spending online, who your friends are, what you do, what you like, where you go, which are the building blocks when you try to understand what people are thinking about. Currently, law enforcement agencies do have the ability to access some of this private information, but they have to give a judge some compelling reason that they need that information. C30 circumvents that, essentially cuts that down to needs. And it's very ironic that this government, in particular, and by the way, just to digress slightly, this isn't just part of the conservative government's context. This isn't just part of the conservative government's frame on civil liberties. The roots of this legislation goes back to the days of the federal liberal government, who tabled the bills initially on lawful access, and I'm sure some of my more learned and versed colleagues will speak to that. But this cuts us at the knees, and what's ironic about it is it came before the House of Commons on the heels of the government's decision after winning the vote to gut the long gun registry. It came on the heels of the government's decision to essentially burn all the records that the registry had accumulated. And their reasoning for that at the time was that to keep this information, this personal private information, was a breach of Canadians' privacy, so therefore we have to get rid of the information. And so that's what they're saying on one hand, and then I don't know if it was the same week. Sometimes these crazy issues blur into one. But then they table this, which seemed an outrageous bit of hypocrisy on their part, but that is also something we are becoming more used to from this government. This is also bad for consumers. So it's bad for privacy, it's bad for consumers. And why is it bad for consumers? So if you're an internet service provider, all of a sudden you have to create a system where you are containing all this personal information and keeping it ready in case there's a request from law enforcement to give over that information, so your data management explodes. Your costs for that explode. Now, who do you think is actually going to pay for that? Well, they're not just going to eat that cost. They're going to turn that cost over to consumers. It's also bad for business because essentially, if you take, for example, BlackBerry, notwithstanding all their issues in the markets right now, have a very secure network. Well, what's going to happen in order to facilitate this new legislation? Providers with very tight security are going to actually have to write into their systems breaches so that they can points of intersection, as it were. And again, some of my colleagues here, I think, will be able to speak more directly about this. But when you think about business and you think about what you're selling to the public, well, one of the things you're going to want to sell if you're an ISP is that confidence and assurance that your system is secure. Bill C-30 undermines the basic premise around security on the internet and the ability for businesses to do their business, to create a relationship with consumers that's one based on what? Well, it's got to be based on trust, otherwise you're going to go somewhere else. So these are some of the critical points here, and again, my colleagues are going to speak to it, but I want to speak to something else which is the fact that this government, which has a majority in the House of Commons, stood up day after day defending this bill to the point where the public safety minister said that if you disagree with this bill, you're standing with pedophiles and child pornographers. That's what he said. He said this in the House of Commons.
Shame.
Now, I thought this was rather curious because about 2 weeks prior to him making this statement, I had done a public event in my riding in Toronto, and not to regale you with stories about where I'm from, but I will say that it's a densely populated riding right downtown Toronto. It's a, you know, where more than half of the people that live there weren't born in Canada, and it spans a socioeconomic range and language skills and interests. And so what I did with my team is I went and knocked on doors in a number of different neighborhoods in the riding to talk about Bill C-30. And, you know, I have kind of a neighborhood of sort of hipster type, under 30 folks who are working in the entertainment and the information sector in Toronto, and they were like, they got it right away. Yeah, this is outrageous. Yeah, I'll sign this petition, no problem. And I kind of knew that was going to happen, but then we went to other neighborhoods that are more traditionally blue-collar, more traditionally working class, more traditionally immigrant, where the first language isn't English, and I talked to seniors, Portuguese seniors, and folks newly from Somalia, and they have the same reaction. This is outrageous. And I thought, okay, we're onto something here. And when you look at the way the government has stalled this legislation, I would argue that part of the reason they have is because in their own base, and here we are in that base in the province of Alberta, people are also letting their voices be heard with their own MPs, because what could be more counter to sort of a libertarian ethos than to have the government allow law enforcement agencies to just grab your personal information without you even knowing that they requested it and have no oversight? Nobody to overlook this. So that raises huge issues of civil liberties. Without getting too wide angle, we see this as part of a trend with this government towards more authoritarian, allowing law enforcement to have more powers, to allow corporations to have more powers through the gutting of regulations, and to keep people so busy with their lives, just barely making ends meet, that they're too busy to notice it's happening. And so, as parliamentarians, that's part of our job. Part of our job is to keep our eye on the ball, because truly, people are busy. People are trying to get, you know, their kids off to school. People are trying to pay for the outrageous cost of daycare, of elder care, of home care, transit. So, this is part of what we have to do, and in closing, I do want to acknowledge that if it weren't for a true community uprising, as expressed through the work of open media, I don't think that the government would have stalled. Because, you know, we can say all the things that we say in the House of Commons, but if the public doesn't get exercised over these issues, then they continue on their merry way. And so it's a real cautionary tale on a certain level about democracy. Because democracy isn't just something that happens during an election. And I know many of you know this, and it doesn't just happen during a by-election. In fact, those can be used as a bit of a showcase as governments quietly whittle away at our democratic rights, our democratic values, which are expressed through strong civil institutions a strong judicial oversight and strong laws that regulate the way powerful entities operate in the common space. And so I do want to thank the folks at Open Media for their work and for the people here today who are going to speak to you in, I think, a bit more detail than me. So thank you so much.
Thanks for that, Andrew. Our first presenter is going to be Brian Seaman from the Alberta Civil Liberties Research Center. Okay. Let's welcome Brian. Okay.
Well, thank you, Andrew, and thank you to the folks at Open Media for bringing us together and providing us with this important opportunity to talk about not only Bill C-30, but also, as I'd indicated to the organizers, I was going to be talking more broadly about my concern and concerns of my colleagues who work in the civil liberties and human rights field by what we see as creeping authoritarianism in our society. I think that there has always been a tendency for persons who were motivated primarily by power and exercising power over individuals. People think that they can tell us what to read, what we can look at, the music that we create, who would dictate to us where we come and go. I think people have always been attracted to positions in the military, and police, and in government, for that matter. Not everybody, because I do believe that there are persons who are motivated by a desire to do good, who do get involved in politics. But I also think that it's an activity that does tend to attract people who are motivated primarily by power. One of the important, fundamental hallmarks of democracy is the right to dissent. I mean, when I look around this room, I mean, about half the people in this room are women. Now, you didn't have the right to vote back in 1867 when this country was formed. Neither, for that matter, would many of the men in this room, unless you were property owners back in 1867. You had to own real property and had to have $4,000 worth of assets, which I don't know what that would translate into real terms in today's dollars, but I'd hazard a guess it's a lot more than $4,000, maybe more like half a million. But I mean, the point I'm making is that in this democracy, we have achieved the rights that we have today, and we have achieved a more representative democracy only because people have dissented in the past. People have fought for and indeed have even paid for the rights that we enjoy today. They paid for that in blood. Look at the Winnipeg strike in 1919. There were women who were beaten. I'm old enough to remember women being beaten up by police in the 1960s. Women who were fighting for the right to access safe and therapeutic abortion. So, when I say this, I am saying this with absolute conviction that, with all due respect to Andrew Cash and to Andrew Mead, who wants to sit in the House of Commons, I think this is an admirable position to want to aspire to, because our parliament is indeed the house which makes our laws. But one of the things that became apparent to me and my colleagues throughout this Open Media campaign was, indeed, as citizens of this country, we have an obligation to man the barricades. And we have an obligation to do the kind of thing that we're doing here today, which is getting together and discussing these issues and not leaving up to the politicians to fight for our rights. These are our rights, and we have to fight for them. And it's important that we recognize that it's a task that we cannot leave up to our political leaders, no matter of what stripe. This creeping authoritarianism, which I've identified, my predecessor at the podium, Andrew Cash, had, I think, alluded to the bizarreness of a conservative ideology, which on the one hand says, yeah, owning a gun is a God-given personal liberty. Nobody can take away my gun. Nobody has a right to know who owns a gun. And yet these are the same people who, they don't seem to be terribly upset over giving law enforcement, over giving bureaucrats carte blanche to look into our internet communications, our email communications, to randomly eavesdrop in our phone conversations, which is what Bill C-30, which was originally called the Lawful Access Act, would give the police the right to do. I mean, an analogy I might like to make would be this. If we as a society are going to be okay with the idea of law enforcement, bureaucrats, being able to intercept our email correspondence, our telephone conversations, if we're okay with that, if we just sit back and say, oh well, you know, if you've got nothing to fear, you've got nothing to hide, well, is it such a stretch then to say that, well, why don't we go even further then and give the police the right to just randomly drop into our houses and see what we're up to? And before, in case anybody thinks that I'm being a little extreme here, in the United Kingdom, for the past 2 years, they started a pilot project about 2 years ago, whereby the homes of 30,000 families who are receiving social assistance now have installed in their homes closed-circuit television cameras. The rationale that was put forward by the authorities was that because these are high-risk individuals, because they're on social assistance, we as a state have an obligation to monitor what's taking place in the homes. Well, aside from this being an obvious war on the poor, are we so naive as to think that incidents of abuse, domestic abuse, violence, incest don't take place in the homes of the well-to-do? Of course they do. But they're not on the radar. This creeping authoritarianism, which I see is so blatant in England, I was there 4 years ago, and as part of my research in connection with a project I'm working on now, I was over there, and there are 4 million closed-circuit television cameras throughout the United Kingdom. I would have expected them in places like tube stations and airports where you have large concentrations of people. But when you're in a little village of 300 people, 6.5 hours north of London, you know, up in the north, and you see closed-circuit cameras everywhere, you got to wonder, what are these cameras being used for? It was sold to the British people as necessary tools in fighting crime and in combating terrorism. And in the post 9/11 world, that is the culture of fear we live in. But in fact, what's been happening in Britain is the local authorities, your municipal councils, your bylaw enforcement officers have been using the images caught on tape to go after people for such threats to civilization as improperly picking up after a dog. I mean, that's an annoyance, but, you know, should it be caught on tape? People who have been jaywalking have been surprised 3 weeks later to receive a summons to appear before a local magistrate to pay a fine. So, in fact, these things are a big cash grab for the state. And this seems to be the way we're going here. So, getting back to my comment a few minutes ago, I just find it very bizarre that persons who self-identify as conservatives who have this distrust of the state. And I think that's a healthy thing for anyone to have. I don't think that you need to be an ideological conservative to have a healthy distrust for the state. It's one of the things that keeps us free, is mistrusting somebody who says, trust me. Invariably that's somebody, next thing you know, he's got his hand in your wallet. So, So I think what I will do is conclude, because I wanted to have a lot of discussion here, and you know, we have an excellent panel here who will address more specific questions, but I will conclude my comments by just saying again, thanks to the folks at Open Media, who I think are responsible in large degree for mobilizing Canadians. And there's a term that comes from the Soviet era, samizdat. In the Soviet Union, of course, it was obviously an authoritarian society. People were afraid to speak out in public, but the people managed to talk amongst themselves in an underground known as samizdat. So in a lot of ways, I think that what's taking place here today, and indeed what's taking place through conversations on the internet, through social media, is the people's version of contemporary samizdat.
Thoughts for sure, lots of conversation to be sparked by that discourse. It's great. So thank you, Brian. Next, of course, we have Tom Keenan from the University of Calgary.
I'm going to tell you a few of them. And some of my favorite stories come from when the media calls me up. About 2 weeks ago, they called. They said, there's this guy in California whose iPad was stolen. Okay, and I said, why is that my problem? They said, well, he knows where it is. He has that Apple tracking feature. And it's in a house in Calgary. And actually, they said he knows it's in a location in Calgary, but the police won't go and get it for him. And this, and I ultimately, you know, saw the guy and everything like that. And the reality was, he did indeed know where it was, and it was down to a particular house. And this kind of illustrates the tension, because the police said, well, you know, first of all, how do we know it's really in that house? Do we believe this technology? You know, this is an approximate GPS location. And by the way, you know, we can't just go knock on somebody's door for this. We have to get a warrant. So I think what eventually did happen in the course of that day is they did trouble themselves to go down and see a judge and get a warrant. The device was indeed recovered and stolen by a baggage handler who works at the Calgary International Airport, so don't trust those guys, and he's now reunited with his device. But it definitely points out the fact that, you know, there's a piece of technology, the my iPad, iPhone, iPod, or whatever can tell me where it is, that the law hasn't even thought about yet. And what if it had been the wrong place? What if it was an apartment building with 100 suites in it? So that could have been a challenge. Another story dates back to the days of the Red Mile, when, you know, the hockey people were all down on 17th Avenue. I get this call from CTV news anchor, and she said, would you mind talking about the phenomenon that's going on down there? I said, Najma, just what phenomenon are you talking about? And she said, well, there are young women burying their breasts on top of cars. And I said, okay, let me get this right. You have some footage of women burying their breasts, and you need a professor to talk about it so you can show this footage. And she said, yeah, that's a possibility. I said, well, you're in luck, because I live a few blocks here, actually, and you just come by and we'll talk. And of course, I gave her what I thought was a fairly amusing thing. I said, well, if one of these girls is up for justice of the Supreme Court of Canada someday, this footage of her riding on top of that car bare-breasted might work against her chances. And that was kind of the end of it. I thought no more about it. So I found out that there was indeed a young woman who was the cart girl at a Calgary golf course who was fired a few days later because she was indeed one of those bare-breasted girls. And the management of the golf course decided that it was too distracting because all the golfers were teasing her and so on. Now, I'm sure she would have had a great wrongful dismissal court case if she had pursued it. But the point is that often things that happen to us involving technology can be self-inflicted. So maybe, you know, the relevance of this is that people don't think too hard when they're using technology, and that is a vulnerability. A few months ago, there was a very, very creepy application that came out on smartphones called Girls Around Me. Anybody heard of it? Hopefully none of you are using it. But what would happen is you'd walk into a bar or whatever, take out your iPhone or your Android or whatever you had, push a button, and you would see all the girls around you. But not only would you see them, you would, if their Facebook profile was public, see their Facebook profile, learn who their favorite band is, you know, learn their relationship status, maybe recently divorced, whatever. And it was considered creepy, so creepy that the New York Times, when they reviewed it, wrote an article, takes creepiness to the new height. Now, the people who wrote this thing in Russia said, we're not doing anything wrong. First of all, we're not actually using anything that these people didn't give out voluntarily. So when they went on Foursquare, which is a check-in service to indicate they were in that bar, they disclosed where they were. When they went on Facebook and made a profile and didn't bother to make it a private profile, they disclosed that information. All we're doing is bringing it together. But of course, that's the point. Most people don't think deeply enough technology to realize what some of the implications are. And in this case, you know, the implication was definitely creepiness. So why are we talking about C30 now? Well, let's be honest, we're talking because there's a by-election here. C30, in fact, I just looked at my parl.gc.ca and looked at the progress bars that they have after each piece of legislation, and C30 is in the very beginning stage, right? So what it says is it's at first reading. And we all know what happened. There was a huge pushback. It was a terrible piece of legislation. We all knew that right away. And I think it's been, what, dispersed to a bunch of committees? Is that where it's sitting now?
It's in the dressing room. Okay. I don't know where it's at.
I know they hid in a bunch of committees.
Yeah.
And the other reason it's in the news, to be fair, is not just because we're going to vote here in a little while. It's also because the Canadian Association of Chiefs of Police came up last week and said, please bring it back, we really need this. Well, I would suggest in fact, you know, they have a lot of powers already. I mean, if you think about it, they're doing a very good job in lots of, with lots of the powers that they do. They can get a search warrant, a general warrant, a wiretap warrant. It's just, as Andrew said, they have to go to a judge, and they may view that as an annoyance. But the other thing to think about, and to drill a little deep on that business about the two different levels of disclosure, with very little threshold, with just like a faint amount of suspicion that someone might be doing something wrong, under that legislation, someone could get the name, the address, and the telephone number, what's called tombstone information about that person. And you know, the people defending the bill say, well, you know, it's like looking you up in a telephone book. The problem is there's lots of things out there that you can do with that email address. In particular, girls around me, the way it made the link between Facebook and Foursquare was by a person's email address. There are programs out there, one is called Spokio, one is called Nautigo, that basically aggregate all of the information that people share on social media. Are these creepy government tools? No, they're creepy private sector tools. You can subscribe to them. And for example, I subscribed for $35 to Spokio, looked up my son who's now 25 years old, and creeped him out totally by saying, I hear you like such and such a band. And he said, WTF, how did you know that? And I said, oh, well, there's a lot of their songs on your playlist at last.fm. He said, how do you even know I have a playlist at last.fm? Now, he's a pretty good hacker, too, so we now have a non-proliferation treaty that neither of us will have each other. But I learned a lot about him, and he's probably learned about, a lot about me. The point is that when you put information out there, you can never get it back. So, you know, I got that information. There are professional tools that are being used to aggregate this information. And I guess the final point I want to leave you with is that we're in North America. So not even getting into the Patriot Act and things that might apply down there, but they certainly do apply. Think about this. There are places in the United States where if you're arrested, this is an example, Hernando County, Florida, go home and go to hernandosheriff.org, and you will find photographs of all the people who were arrested in the last 30 days. And I once took this to the Privacy Commissioner of Canada. I said, would we do this in Canada? And the person said, no, absolutely not. We might allow that for sex offenders or something like that. Well, of course, the reason they do it in Hernando County is that sheriffs are elected officials and they have to appear to be doing their job. So what better way than to show who's arrested? So if we had a overhead thing here, I would show you some examples of the people who were arrested. We don't know that they're guilty, we just know that they were arrested. It gets even better, though, because one of the crimes that's often posted up there is consuming alcohol beverages under the age of 21. Well, that means that they're pretty minor children up there, and in fact, they are. And the most egregious example I found was a 14-year-old boy who was accused of a burglary of a dwelling, and his photograph and his real name and his date of birth was all up there on the internet, and it was up there for 30 days. And we don't know if poor Bobby was innocent or guilty or whatever. I have taken that and put it in the presentation, but obscured his face and obscured his name, so poor Bobby lives on in that example. The point is that information like this just hangs around forever. So once information is starting to accumulate on you, it really never goes away, and that's the reality of it. So we definitely want to err on the side of caution. We don't want to tie the hands of law enforcement, but again, I've worked with enough law enforcement cases to know that they have some pretty good tools at their disposal, at least in North America. You don't even want to try to follow a lead into China or somewhere like that because it only tips a dead end. But the cooperation among at least North American law enforcement is pretty good, and I think they're doing a pretty good job with the tools that they have. Thank you.
Great, thank you for that, Tom. Our last presenter before we get into a question and answer period, which I'll moderate, is Lisa Sear from the Association for Progressive Communication.
Hi, everyone. Thank you very much for having APC speak on this panel. To tell you a little bit about the organization that I work for, we are an international policy advocacy organization, non-governmental organization, and we're focused on the internet and other technologies for development. So throughout the years, as internet progressed, so did the issues. So it's no longer about access, now it's about the fine line between privacy and security and censorship. And so we're not Well, we're certainly not any kind of expert on Bill C-30, but we are very concerned about the direction of internet rights globally, and well, concerned for the future of human rights activists. And bills like these that are cropping up in Canada and across the world are concerning. So basically what we've done is we have a campaign called Connect Your Rights, under which we have an internet rights monitor, and we've been monitoring internet rights violations across the world. And so often when you think of these kinds of violations, you think of Pakistan, you think of the Koreas, you think of China. You certainly don't think of countries like Canada or Germany and you know, UK or wherever else in the West. So it's particularly concerning when you think of that starting to happen in countries like Canada, because there are no leaders. Canada is normally typically seen as a country that upholds human rights, and so to see borderline infringements and to see this creeping authoritarianism, I totally agree with that point of view. It's time for action. So what we've done is we started out working with some of the countries that are members of our networks for the Universal Periodic Review, which is a UN process in which you have a stakeholder submission and you have a state submission, and then that gets put into a larger submission that goes to the UN, and then discussions start to take place between the member states and the UN. And it's meant to be a review and a progress process in which governments become more accountable for upholding human rights in their countries. So they will either explain why they haven't acted on certain things or what they're working on and so on. And so we saw for the very first time at the last UPR in May, they're typically 4-year cycles and then they go to different areas around the world. We saw that internet rights made their first appearance in this review. So that's exciting in a way, because it means that they're finally being acknowledged that something is happening and that things need to be done about it. It's distressful that it's happening in so many countries. So we submitted for Brazil, South Africa, Pakistan, and Ecuador. And so recently, a colleague and I, we did the submission for Canada. And we included Bill C-30 in here. We talked about access as an issue. We talked about the cost, prohibitive cost, which also falls under access. But another main point of ours was also Bill C-30 and the future, any future bill that would be developed from that. So essentially the points that we talked about in terms of recommendations, because as I understood, this is also a discussion that's meant to talk about solutions. We recommended that Canada continue to uphold freedom of expression in Canada by withdrawing or pausing Bill C-30 and any proposed legislation that jeopardizes the privacy and security of online users. So that was one of our points. And then the other one was develop and implement best practices in domestic response to hate speech and discrimination online, and other recommendations that are made by the Special Rapporteur on these rights, such as there's freedom of expression and there's privacy online. So as a member of the Open Media Coalition, the Stop Online Spying Coalition, we would like to see some kind of pan-Canadian working group or something to move forward with these recommendations, because the UPR can be a good point of departure for us to help ensure that these rights are upheld in Canada. So, for example, in Ecuador, we have the person who submitted for Ecuador. She's now having discussions with the government, and she's going to be on an advisory group. So if we can have some kind of working group that can discuss and negotiate with the government and with the people that are putting policies in place, then we can also ensure that the fine line between security and privacy can be met in a healthy way, because right now, getting total lawful access is clearly not the way that a productive way of ensuring security in Canada. And you know, even in the UK, with the examples of the UK, they haven't seen crime rates go down as a result of CCTV. So finding the balance between that through discussions with various stakeholders is definitely the way to do it. And that's why we feel very strongly about the work that Open Media is doing, and we fully support the coalition. So hopefully we can move forward with that. And one of the things that I thought would have been neat to talk about would have been countries that are leaders in this area that we can look upon and say, well, what are they doing, and can we do that in Canada? And there were none. So maybe it's time that Canada became a leader as far as that's concerned, and then if we can be a global leader in helping setting those standards, then maybe we're well on our way. So, thank you.
Great, we do have quite a bit of time for a Q&A, so I'm sure you've been thinking about it and recording your insightful questions, and this is the moment to ask them. Yeah?
Is it all right if I say a couple of things about
Wikipedia? It is okay. What we are going to try to do, though, is ensure that our questions indeed have a question mark after them, and so that we are asking questions of our panelists as opposed to just agents, but I'd love to hear a little bit about it. I'm sure we all would about Wikipedia before you ask a question. Yep. Yeah, sure.
My name is Madison Wozni, and I'm one of the organizers for the Calgary Wikimedia Street Team. I just wanted to make a comment that you can go online to stopspying.ca, and that's the petition in place to fight legislation like security. As of this morning, we were at about 146,000 signatures, so that's really awesome. And just a comment in regards to maybe people being ignorant to the consequences of their actions of interacting with technology. As it was mentioned, one of the other purposes of open media is educating people. So we're also holding events called crypto parties, and that teaches people how they can encrypt their data online, like your email, your private messages, even your whole browsing history, what tools you can use. And that's often in collaboration with Protospace, the hackerspace community in Calgary. So if you want more information on that, you can either talk to me afterwards, or we also have a sign-up sheet at the front of the room where you can sign up for emails from the street team in Calgary. So, and last thought was, there's a great resource, michaelgeist.ca, his blog. He's a law professor and the Canadian Research Chair in Internet and Commerce Law at University of Ottawa, so he's a great research, pardon me, a great resource and all this information, so thanks.
Thanks, and I think Madison will stick around a little bit after we have folks got questions for it. So, questions for our panelists? Yes, sir.
Yeah, my name's Andy Marshall, and I asked somewhat in ignorance, but this issue goes beyond the concern about law enforcement being able to delve into our private matters. And I just want to understand better the extent of other things that are going on. And I was reminded of it during the current election in the States, a sort of benign use of what's portrayed as a benign use of information, that both main political parties are able to identify potential supporters through all kinds of information about their transactions. And I don't know what information they get from the internet or from Google, which of course profiles us now individually. And I don't know whether that information is used, because I understand that even advertising is now geared to what we're interested in. So this goes, seems to go beyond just law enforcement issues. And I wonder what concerns we have in Canada about this happening, whether this can indeed happen here. For example, what appears to be a benign use is identifying individuals who might be supporters, say, of the NDP because of the purchases they've made, and certainly it seems that our purchasing information is now sold, our subscriptions to magazines is now, that's information that's sold, and maybe we agree to that when we buy the product, I'm not sure. So any enlightenment?
When I did a scientific study, you know, the likeness of the last couple of the websites of the major parties, and I specifically looked at tracking cookies. And do you want to guess which party set the most cookies? The NDP. So you were making the more aggressive use of that technology.
Yeah.
Can folks hear that, or should we get our panelists to the microphone to answer questions?
Okay, sure.
Also,
you're good for it.
Yeah, of course. Also, explain what cookies are.
Sure. So, one of the things that happens is that when you visit a website, a little piece of data can be stored on your computer. It's called a tracking cookie. Most websites do them. There are cookie crunchers that will get rid of them and so on. And now this is old data because it was the last federal election, but I was asked by CDC to go out and look at all the major federal parties and their use of cookies. And I did find the most aggressive use of cookies was the NDP. So take it or leave it. But while I've got the mic here, I will say that Facebook probably knows more about you than your significant other. Okay, and using Facebook, Google, information is being accumulated on you, so now you'll start to see not only do you get sort of ads in your Gmail, so if you're talking about golf in your mail, you'll see golf clubs being advertised, but very, very subtle targeting is going on. I even discovered images, because I went to one of these estate sales, and I scrolled down to look at a chandelier, and all of a sudden an ad for chandelier.com comes up there. So I thought, oh my God, they're actually taking the images and analyzing them. But then I realized that the image was called chandelier.jpg. So in fact, that's how they do my book in chandelier.
Wow. I think you raise a good point, and our friend from media actually underlined it as well, which is that we oftentimes don't know what we're agreeing to. I don't know if anyone has actually read when they click on agree at the bottom of when you download a new app or a new piece of software, I don't know if anyone's read that, but I think that our professor here probably has, and many others have. Michael Geist and Ron Diebert and others have read this and have raised serious concerns about what in fact it is we are agreeing to when we click agree. This raises huge issues, and of course, you know, it's also incumbent on not just us as individuals, but policymakers to take this issue seriously. Because, of course, you know, corporations are playing on the fact that you're not going to read them. And, of course, you're not going to read them. It's like asking you to read a very, very detailed contract from a lawyer before you download the app so you can play Angry Birds or whatever it is you're going to play. So it brings up a very big issue, you know, and I think that the other issue that you're talking about is the fact that, you know, we are in an era where information is a commodity, and your personal information has been commodified, and I think this idea of tutorials to teach us how to encrypt our activity online, but also just more broadly to unpack sort of some of what we're actually doing online. And I think that, you know, for young people in particular, I mean, this, you think about this 14-year-old kid who stole something, or a 14-year-old kid who's on a binge, on a drinking binge, or a 15 or 16 or 17-year-old kid who's on a drinking binge at their high school or university, and that gets out there in a sort of public way that can never be removed. And listen, I can tell you that, you know, we all make mistakes when we're young, and that's part of learning how to become a responsible adult, and I think it raises all sorts of very, very serious issues here.
The mic is on the tripod.
Oh, it's on the tripod.
That's what we're trying to say.
Can you hear me okay?
No, it's for the it's just video.
Oh,
it's
just video. Yeah.
But I think a better way to do it is from the
back. There's an idea.
Yeah.
You can just pass this around.
Yeah.
There's an idea in there.
Thanks, Andrew. I guess that's where they pay you the big bucks. as yet one more example of what I see as creeping authoritarianism in our society is this increasing use within legislation of this horrible phrase that you're presumed to consent to something. Your consent to disclosing personal information is presumed unless you specifically object. And the presumption is that all of us, every day, we get up and spend hours reading every conceivable piece of legislation regulation and bylaw that applies to us. This is BS, and we all know it's BS. One example of a presumption clause that comes to mind exists in Alberta's act governing our power grid. We are presumed to consent to the power companies handing over personal information pertaining to our consumption of power to law enforcement unless we expressly say that we don't want that information shared, in which case the police could then obtain it with a search warrant. I mean, that's just one example. There are numerous other pieces of legislation and bylaws where our consent is presumed to disclosure of our personal information. And you better believe it, yeah, there are people who make a lot of money off of buying and selling our information. So even when we're assured that our personal information is going to be kept personal, I'm afraid that I don't think that in practical terms that exists anymore. I mean, we may have this right to personal information and privacy, but I'm very worried that we may indeed have passed the water rule on that point.
Rick, we'll take another question in a moment, but it's interesting to me when we talk about hitting I agree at the bottom of these internet agreements like iTunes and things, that it's kind of like asking the MP to vote on a 420-page harmless budget bill. Anyway, I don't know why that came to mind. Yes?
The U.S. has a much... I'm sorry.
My question is very simple. It seems to me that instead of opening the government, giving the government what sounds like the same access to our information that now private entrepreneurs have, that we should get busy and draft some kind of a bill to regulate the internet. And my question to the people up there is, to what extent is that possible? Or have we unleashed a kind of surreal tiger that eats everything we put out there? Is it possible to regulate the internet? And to what extent is that a possibility? Because that would seem to be a more legitimate role of government to regulate the internet in order to protect private citizens rather than to go in the other direction and say, well, we've got all this information, let's use it whenever we want on whoever we want. So
that's
my question.
Did everybody hear that question? Yes, see nodding.
Okay, I'm not sure with how much detail I can respond to this, but there are large global debates around how precisely how do you regulate the internet. The problem is when you start to control the internet, it becomes a game of who makes those decisions and who can decide what you can access. And you know, right now, on November 6th, there's the Internet Governance Forum, which is taking place in Azerbaijan. And those are the kinds of discussions that they have at those places. How do you decide, you know, what's okay and what isn't, and can you do that on a space that's, you know, free and open, such as the internet? So it's really slippery slope to get into that discussion for those reasons, because, you know, then ultimately someone has the control. And for example, in Iran right now, they have a national internet, basically, where, you know, citizens can go and they can do their online banking, they can go on MSN and chat, and they can do any of that kind of stuff, but they can't necessarily access sites from abroad or sites that would be considered blasphemous or anything like that. So I guess setting that, where you set that bar, and who decides what's good for the people to, you know, to be able to access. So I think that's one of the main discussions that's going on right now, is can you really regulate a place like the internet? Because then the danger is that it's no longer web user-created content, for example, and then it starts to look like something that could be a little bit more like television, where you've got the government or whatever authority saying, this is okay, this can go out, but what you're saying can't come in because it's not right, or it's, we don't agree with it. So I don't know if that helps. I'm sure other people in here can elaborate.
Yes, thank you. It's an excellent question. I also share, though, Lisa's concerns about regulating the internet. There's something about that that really scares me as a civil libertarian, because you know, that can be used as a tool against the kind of thing that we're doing here today. I mean, we're having a town hall here, we're all gathered in a room and we're speaking freely. But I mean, we could also equally have had a town hall where, you know, one of us has set up a page and we communicate online. And there are some countries, a lot of countries in the world, actually probably most countries in the world, as Lisa has referred to, Iran, where that kind of free exchange of information is not possible. Government there indeed sees it as its duty to regulate what people talk about and what they can see online. This very issue has come up before in discussions at the Civil Liberties Research Center. We also have a human rights education wing as part of our responsibilities, and we have human rights educators who are great people and are great friends and whatnot, but we've had some spirited discussions, read emotional, about the issue about whether, for example, it should be unlawful for somebody to post hatred online and to create racist websites online. And it's heinous, but the civil libertarians at our center, myself and a couple other people, it's obviously heinous, but the problem if you make that kind of heinous expression illegal is you drive it underground. I would much rather have an open and transparent society where I know who the idiots are in our midst.
Problem with that when it comes to organizations of pedophiles who are tracking and monitoring 13 and 14 year old girls. I have some problems with this ultimate freedom, and I think a lot of people who maybe start getting soft to the government being able to access. Look, if every corporation on the planet can access everything that I do and say, and I'm a political person, I have a hard time understanding how that guarantees my freedom of movement or expression or action, but that there would be something that protects our children might erode our civil liberties. And I think that's a tough thought for any of us.
What's your name? Mary, I mean, that's obviously an exception. I mean, there is no such thing as absolute freedom. I mean, even our own Charter of Rights and Freedoms, hallowed document that it is, you know, says in the preamble that subject to whatever limits are demonstrably justified in a free and democratic society. And I mean, certainly the abuse of children is a heinous, heinous thing. And indeed, there are exceptions within the criminal code now. I mean, as Tom has alluded, as Andrew alluded, and as I will reiterate, the police now have all the powers that they need within the criminal code to obtain warrants, orders to produce. They can get into these you know, protected accounts of pedophile rings. You know what the problem is? The problem is misallocation of resources. A few years ago, I read that the entire RCMP subdivision that was responsible for monitoring internet activity and checking into pedophiles was comprised of 3 officers. So unless things have changed, 3 RCMP officers are responsible for investigating pedophilic crimes against children on the internet. There's a misallocation of resources. I mean, there are tens upon tens of billions of dollars that are spent, you know, every year to go after people for smoking marijuana. I mean, the mass majority of inmates in our institutions are there because of crimes related to drugs.
But if we could turn this into a dialogue for a moment. I'm not a great computer person, but I imagine that the brains and the technology that created the internet could make a system that would flag those pedophiles and those organizations and shut them down tomorrow. And so blaming it on traditional police not having allocated enough resources to catch those people, and then saying, but we have to let them, those guys roam freely and play the little games in chat rooms in order to guarantee. There's something about that that doesn't make sense.
I'm going to pass the microphone over to Tom because he can speak about the technological aspects of what you're referring to. I will say that if the police can provide at least some evidence to a judge or justice of the peace that there's a crime being committed, they can produce a search warrant to access a person's internet activities, but Tom could probably talk about how investigative.
Well, thankfully, there are more than three RCMP officers assigned to this now. There also are vigilante groups that go out there. But the real answer to your question is you protect your kids. So if you took an example, there is a site called Nexopia. Who's on Nexopia? Looks like Facebook, smells like Facebook. I know the founder of it. He lives in Edmonton. He has a t-shirt that says Nexopia because your mother is on Facebook. And Nexopia allows younger children to get on. It also allows a sort by age and residence and gender, sexual preference, and so on. Is Nexopia legal? Apparently it is. It's been around for 10 years now. Should your child be on it? Probably not. On the regulation by government, China has a great firewall of China. One of the unintended consequences is that Kindles are, those Kindle readers are extremely valuable in China, and they sell for a premium on the Chinese equivalent of eBay, because they go through a server in Seattle that gets around the Great Firewall of China. I was personally in a hotel in China. I was talking to my editor back here in Calgary, and I said, let's try SMS messaging and see if they censor that. So I said, Lisa, send me the Tibet flag, which is explicitly forbidden in China. So she sends me the image, Tibet.jpg, and I just was about to answer. I said, wait a minute, somebody's knocking on the door. And I just waited for 5 minutes. She said it was the longest 5 minutes of her life. But as of then, anyway, they were not censoring SMS messages. And, you know, it's kind of inevitable that the truth will get through and people find ways around it. There are, there's a project called Tor, if you go, you know all about Tor. And Tor, among other things, helps human rights advocates by setting up one-time addresses. So even if their government comes after them, what they find is that the address is now dead because it was a one-time pad that allowed them to communicate. So it's a complicated thing, but you know the real answer for your kids is it comes from you, not from the government.
I think that's
important.
Yeah,
I'm
good too.
Ma'am. Well, that's the kind of answer that I hear in my hometown when there's a conversation around speeding down the street, and it reminds me of someone at a door once, and a car went zipping down the street. And this was a street where some of the neighbors wanted to put some speed bumps on. And I was at a door and I asked the guy at the door, well, what do you think about speed bumps? And he said to me, I'll tell you the answer to this is not to reduce the speed of the car or impede the speed of the car. It's your job as a parent to make sure your kid doesn't get hit by that. And I think that the internet is a fast, fast, fast moving car on a very narrow road. And at the side of those roads are children and young people. And if you think that the answer to this is that, and I have great respect for my honorable colleague, because that's what I say, the conservatives across the way. I don't have to do that in the House of Commons. But if you think that the answer to this is simply the parent's job, that's just like saying the answer to unplanned pregnancy is the parent's role, you know. And I think that's something that, you know, we have to take ownership of as a society.
We give the most responsibility to the people with the least power.
Now, I needed to rebut that, but I do want to say that in terms of the question, the initial question, right, is about can we regulate the internet? And the answer really is the internet is regulated already. The internet is being regulated before your eyes. Bill C-11, our copyright bill, which was essentially lobbied heavily by American multinational entertainment industry to lock down content that in the guise that somehow, you know, Hollywood and the music industry were threatened by a grandmother downloading 20 songs or a kid downloading 20 songs. No, of course, there's people that are downloading tens of thousands of songs and distributing them for free, but that is happening. But there's all sorts of things that are happening that are not infringing copyright, but suddenly now those things are becoming illegal activities. So I think that the answer is that we need to engage. We need to engage. And I just give an example of the international conversation around
around the internet, the setting the terms for essentially human rights on the internet. Now, if liberal democracies aren't at that table, engaged in that conversation, then who's going to be talking about it? Now, my friend here mentioned Iran. Why don't we talk about China? Because, of course, right here in Alberta, we are talking about China because the Chinese state, through a surrogate, wants to buy the 12th largest oil company in Canada. Now, this is a country that does not have free access to the internet. But they are here, and there's many things that's very interesting about China, as there are many things that are very interesting about Iran. But we need to be clear about what we are interested in. And if we're interested in a robust, free internet that could protect our privacy while at the same time providing the security that we need, then we got to start talking about it in real terms, not just doing the Vic-Tates thing, which is basically saying that if you don't buy our legislation, you're standing with pedophiles.
So we've got a bit of a speakers list happening now. While I appreciate the discourse back and forth, I think there is going to be some time for that afterwards at a pub nearby, and so let's keep that in mind. So the speakers list we've got going on so far is stripy shirt, awesome scarf, cool hat. Is that what we're out? Okay? And so, and we've got a few others afterwards, but we'll start with stripy shirt. Do you want to come on up because
we're down there.
Yeah, I bring the mic down.
I'll project. I think
okay.
I'm stripy shirt.
Hi.
I'm an American, and I've been living in Canada since 2003, so I'm a citizen of both countries, but I'm very concerned with U.S. politics. I'm aware that in the U.S., civil liberties, which is almost completely absent from the current election there, except for Ron Paul, who is being discredited as he's kind of a joke candidate. And I'm very liberal, but I feel like in a lot of ways, I have more in common with him than my guy, Obama, who's a Democrat, because I'm a Democrat. And there's a very developed police state, surveillance state being put into place in the United States. Is this how much of a concern is this to us as Canadians? And I'm not talking about the halo effect of Stephen Harper wants to be Bush. I'm talking about we engage in activities online. Is there anything we need to be concerned about what the U.S. is monitoring? Because a lot of us as Canadians do business in the U.S., we travel to the U.S., we have relatives in the U.S. And so that's my question is, should we have as much to fear of the U.S. government as much as the Canadian government?
Well, there's a million ways to answer that question, but let's just limit it to internet practices, for example. Now, in the United States, if an entity believes that you're infringing copyright, then there's a regime called notice and takedown, where you give a notice and then you got to take it down. In Canada, in our new copyright legislation, which was just recently passed, the regime is notice and notice. So you get notice, a notice is delivered, and then the notice is sent to the ISP. And then there's a certain amount of time to take that down. You just learned recently that the government has sort of taken that part of the legislation, and we're now thinking they've taken it out, and now we're thinking they're actually going to come back with a much more aggressive notice and takedown regime. That's directly coming from pressure from the United States. So I think they're the biggest. They're our big neighbor, everything they do affects us. And
IP aside, I'm talking about, I make a comment, a political comment, say something that supports the Occupy movement, I will go a little far with my comments, suddenly I'm noticed. Am I going to end up on a no-fly list? I mean, do you end up going through, like the example at the front there is, so-and-so makes a comment, so-and-so ends up being surveilled, and this information is collected. They're a lot better at it down south than they are here, and the consequences are much bigger down south than they are here. Yeah. So, what do we need to do to protect our rights, and what are the possible infringements on our rights?
There's a YouTube video called "Does What Happens in the Facebook Stay in Facebook," And if you watch it, it's about 3 minutes long. You'll see it's a conspiracy theory that the CIA funded the Facebook. And it has some evidence having to do with interlocking venture capitalists and so on. I know someone senior enough in the CIA that was able to pose that question and give what I think was an honest answer. He said, Tom, no, we did not create the Facebook. But if it didn't exist, we probably would have done it. And we use it every day. And it's a major investigator, too. And there is on the Onion News Network a mock award to Special Agent Mark Zuckerberg for cutting down the investigative costs of the CIA by 90%. And by the way, not only do they tell us what they've done, they tell us where they're going to be next Thursday so we can go and arrest them.
Yes, we do need to be concerned. But and we need to always be vigilant, but in a lot of ways, we haven't opened up the barn door, and the barn's on fire, and the horses are dying. Where do I begin? In the province of British Columbia, the province of British Columbia maintains a health database, as do all provinces, and indeed the federal government maintains a database of citizens. A few years back, the very same company in the United States, data management company that is retained by the Central Intelligence Agency, is the same company that was contracted to manage this database of health database of British Columbia citizens. What's wrong with that on your face? On the face of it, well, would you be interested in knowing that under the terms of the Patriot Act, that if the Central Intelligence Agency makes a request to the British Columbia Ministry of Health for health files of any citizen, because this person is a terrorist suspect or on a watch list, and increasingly it doesn't take too much to get on a watch list down there, then the health ministry is obligated to provide not only identifying information about that individual to the Central Intelligence Agency, but also that person's health records. So, where else do I continue? Under bilateral agreements between law enforcement agencies and American law enforcement agencies, in this culture of terror, the culture of fear that we live in post 9/11, the Federal Bureau of Investigation and the Central Intelligence Agency, and indeed any American law enforcement agency, can cross the Canadian border and arrest any citizen or resident of Canada if they are deemed to be a suspect or a person of interest in connection with the Patriot Act. You don't even have to commit a crime in the United States anymore to attract the attention of law enforcement authorities. A few weeks ago, through Facebook, I learned about a young man in a city in Virginia who was picked up by the police and detained in a psychiatric institution for assessment prior to appearing before a judge. The happy end of the story is that the judge ordered the guy released. He was a young man, a veteran from Iraq, and he posted a page on Facebook in which he said things that, granted, the guy obviously doesn't have a high education, but the things that he said are things that a lot of educated people have said, that we don't think we're getting the full truth about what happened on 9/11. There was some very pointed criticism about the deregulation of the American financial industry that took place under Reagan and continued down to the present day, and about how the 1%ers were essentially corporate criminals who were destroying America's Constitution. And he said, I think it's time as Americans that we rose up and had the second revolution. And, you know, he's a young guy and he's posted there, you know, was bare-chested and holding a gun. So, based on that, the police in this Virginia city thought, well, this is a guy who might go nuts, and so they picked him up and held him against his will in a psychiatric institution for assessment. And the happy ending of the story is that a judge in Virginia, when presented with this evidence, said, this is not evidence. It's not a crime in the United States to criticize the government, no matter how dramatically, and it's not a crime to have a photograph of yourself holding a gun. So, there is a culture of fear down in the United States. Is it spilling over into this country? Yes, unfortunately so.
I'll just add quickly, just given the way that things are going, And given the fact that what goes online stays online, I think it's totally reasonable to be weary of how things could go, because maybe now, because the rights that we have today may not be the rights that we have in 20 years, and it could be that in 20 years, having said something against the U.S. government could put you on some sort of list. So it may not be a tangible, direct issue right just yet, but given the way things are going, it could be later on. So it doesn't really.
Great, so thank you.
I just wanted to ask if there's any potential in an anti-C30 bill. You know, like actually introducing a bill that is proactive rather than, like, it seems to me that the strategy of this government right from the very beginning is to introduce issues at the top end, make everybody really react, and then try to get whatever they can at the bottom. And this is a business technique. You know, a very sophisticated public relations campaign that makes us all scramble, you know, and react. But I think we need to be proactive and start to fight back in that way.
Like, you know, changing the
if
government.
We can introduce a bill that, you know, rather than running around and, you know, we're losing our energy.
Yeah, well, I mean, there may be many initiatives. One that I know of, and I think it is interesting, and it's Anne Kavoukian, who's the Information Privacy Commissioner for Ontario, who's been very outspoken about C30. It's part of a group that's developed what's called Privacy by Design, where it's a regime whereby this stuff, the privacy issues that we're talking about today, are part of the way ISPs and the way telecoms develop their systems, so that it's basically integrated from the get-go, as opposed to the way it is now, or the way it would be if C30 has its way. So that's one example, and I can't go too far into it, but I just wanted to mention that one. Many others know. Others.
I don't know of any anti-C30 bill, but I just want to read something from our submission that basically says, in 1971, the government of Canada acknowledged the right to communicate and the right to privacy as a basic human right, and consensus that a legal concept of invasion of privacy should be introduced in provincial and federal law, granting Canadians the right to communicate privately and to disconnect at will. But so today, we have the right, Canadians have the right to physical privacy, freedom from surveillance, freedom from monitoring or interception of their private communications, and freedom from the collection, use, and disclosure of their personal information. But these are exactly the things that we see happening.
But this is not, you know, if you read the Privacy Act in Alberta, what you'll find is that it's, in many cases, in opposition to what the Federal Privacy Act, I mean, those are great things, but in actual fact, it's legal to export information. And I'll give you an example. Like, when you do a search on Calgary Public Library, it goes to a couple of sites. One of them's in New Jersey, and the other one's in near Salt Lake City. Provost. And so your information, and what you're searching for, goes down to the United States. It's actually your information is exported, and that's, if you look at the Privacy Act of Alberta, that's legal. And so that is, you know, to say something about what the health records, you know, is probably one of the worst things, because in BC we saw health records being exported, and this government wants to have a national health record thing, which. In Alberta, it's legal to give some private company, and I read the privacy commissioner's book, and as she says, once that information, for example, in the health records, goes into an insurance company, you know, you have a car accident just up here, and you give all this information, and you say all these things, they're personal, and that information, where does it go from that insurance company? Well, I'll tell you, it probably goes to Mutual of Omaha, or some American company that entity that owns it, and they may not even anymore be an insurance company, you know, and they indeed may be owned by somebody in China or some other country. So local privacy laws, you know, it's Alberta is a barn door. There is no privacy in Alberta. So when you, and this has come up recently, you know, on the media, and it's scary because most people think they get the media from, you know, off the Ottawa thing, but they don't realize that there's no privacy actually in Alberta. So we need to have, I think, an anti, somebody, a member has to introduce a bill that addresses these issues really.
In a proactive way.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Great, great question. Cool Hat.
Hi, I'm Cool Hat. Our friend from the NDP had mentioned, I'm going to paraphrase here, our colleague here mentioned Iran. Why don't we talk about China? I want to know why we are so gung-ho to create through conjecture and anecdotal evidence boogeymen over there when we're not, when we have boogeymen here that are hollowing out democracy left, right, and center. And we have major, major evidence, you know, the destruction of the human rights and you know, Center for, you know, Democracy Development that was destroyed this year. We have the destruction of the lessening of money being put to, you know, the Human Rights Commission. We have the attack on the status of women. We have the Bev Otis scandal. We have the In and Out scandal. We have a boogeyman here in Canada, but yet we are so gung-ho on creating, through conjecture and anecdotal evidence, boogeymen over there. Why don't we talk here about the ideas of democracy when we talk about democracy in Canada? As if democracy is some kind of homogeneous thing, when it is not. If you look at Hitler's Nazi regime, if you look at Mussolini, they got fascism through a continual whittling down of democratic institutions. So should we ask ourselves here, do we use the term democracy to benefit the state in some, as some kind of psychological warfare to pacify us? So do we need to start talking more about what's happening here and how we can organize to actually get rid of this growing fascism here instead of looking and say, I perceive there's a boogeyman over there.
Well, thanks for that. And, you know, of course, it's not mutually exclusive. Well, obviously, you know, we talk about the whittling away and the destruction of democracy here, and it's incumbent on us to talk about that wherever it exists. And I think, you know, the top grossing movie right now has created a boogeyman in Iran. And I think that your points are very, very important. I reference China because not to create a boogeyman, but the very fact that it doesn't matter whether it's China or any country, do we really want a state, another state, owning a vital part of our energy infrastructure? It's a fair question to ask, and it's part of how we develop, maintain, nurture, and build democracy to ask that question and to have a robust debate about it. That is what we're talking about here. I think that there are forces, and I think many of them are in the conservative government, that would like to frame the debate around Nixon and Sinuk as those in opposition to it creating some kind of a bogeyman. When in fact, what people who are opposing this takeover are concerned about is, where is our economic sovereignty here? And where do we, how much is too much? And I think that's an important question to ask. That's the question that really government that's the question government asks all the time, right? Because every decision is a balance of factors. I agree with you. I think that on some level, we, as other global events take over, we're seeing our own democracy being hollowed out. I would also argue that many of us are spending, you know, our lives fighting to preserve and maintain the democracy that we have, to express it, to articulate it, so that
wouldn't it be more effective for the NDP to quit en masse and join a popular rebellion on the ground?
I think that we are part of popular movements, and popular movements are made up of many aspects of society, including the political component of society. I think it's part of those pieces that build an en masse movement for change.
Great. Your comments resonated strongly with me for many reasons, because I have spoken before about this creeping authoritarianism in our society. Bit by bit, we can lose our freedoms until we get to the point where we're wondering, how did we get here? Well, we've all heard that analogy about the frog in water, right? You know, we keep raising the temperature, and the frog just adjusts the temperature until it's cooked. I think that your references to Italy and to Germany, in the third decade of the last century are very apt. I mean, it's a lesson for all of us that we can, as a society, democratically elect a government that is fundamentally undemocratic. Or we could also have a society, which is where I think we are right now, where we have a government that is slowly, if we allow it to, whittling away at our freedoms. This gentleman had asked, why don't we have a proactive anti-Bill C-30? I think we already have something even more important, that is the Charter of Rights and Freedoms. With the Charter of Rights and Freedoms, which is the fundamental law of the land, and indeed represents the codification of hundreds of years of evolution of English common law. And I think that we ought not to take that charter for granted. And I think it's important to continue to exercise our right to question and indeed to dissent. I mean, we have a right as citizens to take our issues to the streets. We have a right to assemble peacefully and to protest peacefully. Thirdly, regarding the China situation, the CNOP situation, well, that's something which we've been discussing at a research center as well, because not only would this deal that went through this CNOP purchase and then ultimately this FIPA agreement with between Canada and China, if that was ratified, not only will it lead to the loss of our economic sovereignty, but it's going to lead to the loss of the right of, I don't understand why business people are not all over this, because hello, if you get involved in a dispute, if you want a company that's supplying, say, a pipeline, supplying CNOP, and you get involved in a commercial dispute, well, you have the right under this FIPA agreement to negotiate some kind of a settlement with China's large state-owned oil company. Good luck with that. If you're not able to negotiate the settlement of your bill, well, guess what? You have to submit to a third-party tribunal subject to binding arbitration, which means that you have effectively ceded away your rights under the Charter of Rights and Freedoms. So I don't think we should be allowing Stephen Harper to marginalize us into, those radical eco-terrorists or, those radical Aboriginals, on the warpath again. And, we ought not to be allowed to be marginalized and split apart and divided and conquered on this issue, because this is a matter that should be a fundamental concern to all Canadians, irrespective of what they do for a living. And, business people, you better understand that this is not a bunch of tree huggers out here who are raising concerns about it. And we do have some valid environmental concerns, so I'm using that term ironically. We're all in this together, otherwise we'll all hang together and we'll be subject to the dictates of communist China, not only in regards to our economic sovereignty, but with regard to our rights and freedoms.
Great. In the interest of time, we're going to take two more questions, and I'd appreciate it if those questions were directed to any panelists, a single panelist if we can, so we're here.
We can take the two questions, then we can wrap up, without answering each one individually.
Sure. So go ahead, ask your question.
Kind of a follow-up to what you were saying about how it's the responsibility of parents to monitor their child's time on the internet, because I'm a mother of a 7-year-old, and I'm pretty fortunate because I have a spouse who knows something about computer security, but how is a parent to know how, like, to do that.
Where's your computer in your house?
In the kitchen.
Okay, so do you ever walk by while your child's on it?
Yeah, I do, but still, I think that that's, I agree with Mary, that that's a bit of a cop-out to say, oh, let's just put this in the parents' hands, because your child is going to spend some time at the computer unsupervised to do schoolwork. It's, you know, yeah.
Your child go to the
park. Mary, so we're going to take the two questions?
Sure.
Thank you, Dan. I see one of the biggest problems we have in preventing Bill C-30. We live in a state of fear now, post 9/11. Some of it valid, most of it thinly veiled, used by law enforcement and governments to gain greater control. And the common attitude out there of so many is what will allow a bill like this to go through, that attitude of, well, if I'm not doing anything wrong, I shouldn't have to worry about it. If you're not doing anything wrong, why are you getting so upset about it? That is the very lack of oversight and concern that will allow this to go through. So if you can address how you think we can change that attitude in the public, because that's the only way we can prevent this from going through.
Great. And maybe we'll take the last question in the back, since it seems to be the only other one.
Thank you. Remember, this day is upon us. This is the time to honor those who fought and died and continue to fight for our rights and freedoms. I'm sure we enjoy today. I would like those rights and freedoms for my children. I don't think the government should be surveilling Canadian citizens without a warrant. What is the most effective way to stop Bill
C-30 from going through? Great, excellent question. So what about sort of the parents' role in internet security? I think we all remember the other two, so we're all set.
Well, I think I'm going to take the gentleman's the last question first. Because really, you know, democracy is a living and breathing thing that needs tending and support and strengthening every single day. And it needs that from the Occupy movement, it needs that from academics, it needs that from faith-based community groups, it needs that from the agencies that are working in our communities, it needs that from students, it needs that from everybody. We need to take this seriously. You know, and I think that, I think that you, you know, kind of underline the import of this. You know, we here in our country, we, you know, we're wearing the poppy and we're remembering this sacrifice that men and women have made, right? But if we don't actually take it for real, and, you know, if we don't actually take this seriously, then you know, we abrogate our responsibility as citizens, right? And I want to say that with the deepest respect, because people in our society today are so damn busy just trying to get by that, and things are moving at such a fast pace that it's very difficult. And you see this in the statistics around membership in the Rotary Club and the Lions Club and various community organizations. You see it in the declining membership because people are so busy. So we've got a lot of work to do. But I think that is not just up to the politician. It's not just up to the parents. You know, it is a collective communal issue that we have to deal with. And I'd also argue, just on the parent side, because I think my friend here mentioned that his son's 25, and I have a 21-year-old, but I also have a 7-year-old, and a 5-year-old, and a 1-year-old. And I can tell you that the difference between the screen time and the pervasiveness of the internet today for young people is so much more intense than it was when my 20-year-old was 7 years old. So we've got just a wild explosion of a technology that we don't yet really, many of us, most of us, have not yet really wrestled with. And certainly the minute we wrestle that to the ground, a new iteration of it emerges, and then we have to deal with that. So that's why these things, I think, are so important here today. Right.
Yeah. To start with, maybe the parents' role. I think parents do have a role to play, but obviously it's difficult because of this gap that's taking place at such a phenomenal speed. I also think, you know, even schools should take a more active role, especially when you're seeing all these things like cyberbullying and the recent case of suicide. These are things that can't be left entirely up to the authorities, but also, for example, we have a campaign that we do in November every year. It's called Take Back the Tech, and it's focused primarily for women and girls on how to be more secure online and how to, even simple things like regularly changing your password and what's a safe password, because a lot of people, not just in Canada but everywhere around the world, can have limited knowledge around these things. So part of it is there's an individual responsibility as a parent or as a citizen and as a person, but because of the speed, it's unrealistic to think of people being able to keep up with it. Because I work in internet and technology for development, and it's even too much for me at times because it's just continually going faster. So obviously, having the right policies put in place can help that, I think. So that'll be one of the first steps. And to speak to the last question was also, well, I like the idea of an anti-Bill C-30, but I also feel like these rights are already there. They're just not being observed or protected. So, how do we bring more focus to that? I guess more discussion and then more stringent application of the rights and upholding these rights. But might be time to start thinking about how to protect these rights and how to keep them. Because it's a really, I find, frightening and unfortunate thing that I have to fight so hard for rights that have been granted to me already. Like, it feels like we've already had this discussion. Why are we having it, some 30, 40, however many years later? So, obviously, these bills, it all needs to be revisited and then reapplied to the context where technology is playing a huge role in our lives. Because it's, we're pretty much living and breathing technology nowadays. So,
Right. Well, there were a number of questions and a number of issues, so I'm going to just speak generally and hopefully address most, if not all, of those questions and concerns. Listening to the two chaps that I've been talk about their kids' activity on the internet brings to mind an acronym that all the kids are familiar with is POS, which means parent over shoulder, which of course is what they text or post on the Facebook discussion as soon as mom or dad is walking through the room. I don't want to live in a country where POS means police over shoulder. Police obviously play a very important role in our judicial and criminal justice system. I have a first cousin who's a Mountie. My boss has a couple of relatives who also were Mounties. Readers of the Calgary Sun might think that civil libertarians are all about, letting the criminals run amok. Well, we're not. Civil libertarians believe in a civil society and civil rights and civil liberties, and civil liberties are obtained through a democratic and civil society. In terms of what we can do to ensure that these rights aren't whittled away, I think that in a very real sense, gathered here today having this kind of town discussion, which is subsequently going to be broadcast through YouTube or on the open media site, is an important way to get the word out. I think it's important also to recognize that though the internet, social media in particular, Facebook, can be an important tool for getting information out to a wide variety of people, it's not the only way and it's not the best way. As a friend of mine put it cynically on a post the other day, she said, you know what? Clicking like to a statement that I'm opposed to genocide in Darfur is not going to end genocide in Darfur, okay? The problem I see is that there's a lot of people think that they click like, you know, to whatever cause is going around. It makes them feel good for them that moment, and they feel better about themselves, but it does nothing about the problem. So what's really important is to gather together, like we are here today, and like Funny Hat Guy, you know, has organized peaceful demonstrations.
Cool hat.
Sorry. That's really important, because we do have a right in a democracy to assemble peacefully, and it doesn't make us echo radicals and terrorists. In fact, that's the only way that we're going to get through this dark period of conservative rule.
So the parent thing, of course, there's POS and everything else. And of course, I used to say, don't let your kid have the computer in her or his bedroom, but this is the computer now, so you have to be aware of that as well. However, if your kid's on Facebook, if your kid's on Nexopia, if heaven forbid your kid is on Chatroulette, if you don't know what that is, go look into it. Chatroulette was invented by a horny 17-year-old in Russia. We did a focus group of teenagers. We said, what do you see on Chatroulette? This is penises. That's the main thing we see. So you want to look into whether your kid's using that. And I have a proactive exercise you can do if your child doesn't have a Facebook account. Help them create one using a picture of Marge Simpson or Homer Simpson or something like that. And then let them go to a Facebook application called Take This Lollipop. And I'll just leave it as homework for you all, because I'm a professor, to go and add Take This Lollipop to your Facebook thing. It basically simulates an extremely creepy stalker using your Facebook information, and the last scene of it is this creepy guy driving up to your house based upon Google Maps location and a photo of you on the dashboard of his car. So most 8-year-olds are going to be pretty impressed by that. Maybe they'll want you to delete that Facebook account. On the question about building some awareness, one thing you could do is keep a log of all of your surfing for a week. And at the end of the week, if you find that you looked up fertilizer because you wanted to fertilize the back 40 or something, you might be on a watch list of people who want to build fertilizer bombs. So just about any of us in the course of the week probably does something that somebody would find suspicious. And then the last one, an anti-C30, one thing that nobody's mentioned, this thing is a potential gold mine for the ISPs. The ISPs get a fee for doing the work of the government. That fee has no limit set on it in the original version of Bill C-30. The ISPs are licking their lips, thinking about all the fees that they'll get to do all these disclosures on behalf of the government. So perhaps, in fact, there ought to be a very strict limit set on that fee. And I think if they did that, you would find that, in fact, the ISPs would suddenly decide that this is not such a good idea after all, and they would join the opposition to C-30.
Well, thank you all for coming today. I hope you learned as much as I did about Bill C-30 and some of the ways forward. There are a few things that we need to do to end the session today. One, of course, is to thank all of our panelists. So let's do that. Most especially, we flew in from Ottawa, flew in from Toronto today to be with us this afternoon. So an extra special thank you to him. And a note that we are going to continue this conversation. It feels to me as though there's lots more to say on this topic, and people in the crowd and the audience really want to be able to interact with one another. We are going to do that starting right away at the Union Station Tap House, which is 2118 33rd Avenue Southwest, just a couple of blocks from here on 33rd in the main strip there of Marbaloop. And for those of you that are interested, Andrew and I both brought guitars, and so we're going to sit and have a bite to eat and maybe a pint of beer and play some songs as well. So come on out there. I think it's going to be a lot of fun. We can keep talking about this and lots of other important issues. So thank you all for coming, and enjoy the rest of your evening.